So today, instead of presenting an article or journal, I'm going to present some data that we have generated in the endocrine department with a medical student who was doing a BSc project with Professor Mirren's group with us. In particular, we're talking about redefining the insulin tolerance test cortisol thresholds for diagnosis of adrenal insufficiency. So background here is that the insulin tolerance test is the gold standard for diagnosing adrenal insufficiency, although it's not used predominantly because of risk associated with the procedure itself. The way that the dynamic function test works is to induce a hypoglycemic stress. We're looking for a glucose of less than 2.2 following an insulin load. This test is very useful because it tests the entire HPA axis. So if we consider the SST, the short synactin test, when using synactin, we are only stressing the adrenal. We are not testing the function of the pituitary. We are not testing the function of the hypothalamus. Having said this, there's good data out there showing that there's very good agreement between the SST and the ITT, with the exception of a few specific circumstances. Now, the diagnostic cutoff values are very important. So if we introduce very high values, then what we will do is overdiagnose AI, adrenal insufficiency. If we overdiagnose adrenal insufficiency, then we are consigning a massive group of patients to unnecessary steroid replacement. And with that comes the risk of diabetes, thin bones, heart disease, and essentially a reduction in their life expectancy of approximately, or not approximately, but rather up to 12 years. At the same time, if we institute very low values, then we will miss diagnoses of AI, and the underdiagnosis of AI can lead to adrenal crises. And if an individual has an adrenal crisis, we are talking about a 2.4% risk of death with each episode. So we need to be very careful to find the right balance. But when an individual has an adrenal crisis, depending on where you are, the risk of death at that point is approximately up to 2.4%. If you're in Japan, that risk is a lot lower. If you're in the UK, I don't think there's a specific one for the UK, actually. If you're in Europe, it's up to 2.4%. I'm sorry, the other point was, the threshold values, historically, we want them high because we never really wanted the situation where patients might have an adrenal crisis. I think the emphasis is now changing because we're better at dealing with adrenal patients and hypoadrenal patients. So to give you a bit of background, we're going to talk about why we have the values that we do now. So at Imperial, we use 500 nanomoles per liter. So if a patient exceeds 500, then they do not have AI. If they do not achieve 500, then technically they have AI. The traditional value used, and you might find it's used in other centers, is actually 550 nanomoles per liter. Now, this value harks from this seminal paper from Plumpton and Besser in 1969. So in this paper, Plumpton and Besser took 20 controls and 20 patients treated with steroids. Of the 20 that were being treated with steroids, 11 had previous steroid treatment and 9 had ongoing steroid treatment. All of these individuals had an ITT and they were all subjected to major surgery because they needed it, not for the purposes of the study. And we ended up with these profiles. So is my mouse projecting? I'll assume it is, but please do tell
me. It is.
So what you will see here is on the left, what happened with the ITT. So you'll see that when the controls were given their insulin tolerance test, they peaked at about 30 micrograms per deciliter. So 20 is approximately 550. So we're talking about 750, let's say, around here. And during the surgery day, you'll see that time point zero, the operation starts, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 hours after, it starts to go up and it stays up. And we're talking at about a level of 1,100 nanomoles per liter at the level of 40 micrograms per deciliter. And then over the coming days, it starts to come down. When we compare this to the 9 individuals who were on active glucocorticoid treatment, you'll see that their ITT response is certainly blunted. You will also see that during surgery, the majorities, this is 7 of the 9, did not mount an adequate cortisol response. these two are outliers. So these two individuals did mount a good response, and that's why they were separated out. And it's potentially the case that these two were tertiary adrenal insufficiency, if indeed they were adrenally insufficient here. Another important paper is Stewart et al, 1988. So Stewart et al, 1988, compared 70 SSTs and ITTs from 58 individuals. All of these individuals had different pituitary conditions. There were one or two idiopathic hyperpituitaryisms. So the reason to bring this paper up is that in Edinburgh, for reasons unknown to us in 1988, instead of using 550 nanomoles per liter cutoffs for the ITT, they actually were using 500. And for the SST, they were using 550. And you'll see on the graph here that they actually had good agreement between the 30-minute cortisol value on an SST versus the peak cortisol on an ITT. And this is what we expect. What I'm showing you here are the 10 individuals who actually had discrepant SST and ITT results. The top nine here, from the acromegaly all the way down to this prolactinoma, actually failed the SST, but passed the ITT. So remember, the SST, the cutoff is 550. The ITT, the cutoff is 500. The individual at the bottom, this person actually passed the SST and failed the ITT. So this one is certainly an outlier. But the reason to show you this table is to demonstrate that those who fail or have discordant results, rather, they are very close to the boundary. So it's these gray area cases that we really are interested in when we start trying to change cutoff values. So the next important paper to talk about is Hurrell et al, 1996. So in this paper, they had 30 individuals who were subjected to an SST. Of these 30, 27 had an additional ITT. The group then tried to define an ITT cutoff from the maximal cortisol response minus two SDs. They came up with a number of 520. Now the graph on the right, or the two graphs on the right, this is the SST response up here, which I'm not going to focus on, but the ITT result here, you can see the majority of healthy volunteers peaked at about 600 to 700. And you can see this nice, slightly negative skew on a normal distribution. Now, the important points here are that this group used a Kodak assay. So it's an assay that's not used today, and I have no familiarity with it at all. And they took the value, the 520 nanomole per liter value, and they tested it on 166 individuals from the patient group to see if these values would hold true. And essentially they said that the values do work. The other finding that they had that was quite significant was that if you see an individual who has an SST response at 30 minutes of greater than 600, the group concluded that you did not need to proceed to an ITT in these individuals, that the ITT was going to be normal. And I think that was with 95% sensitivity. And the last paper I'm going to talk about here is Ku et al, 2017. So this is a paper that was generated here at Imperial. So 97 new adrenal healthy volunteer patients, I guess, who were undergoing surgery were categorized as either major surgery, moderate surgery, or minor surgery. So we've got 37 majors, 33 moderates, and 23 minors. This study is essentially a mirror of the Plumpton and Besser paper that I showed you at the beginning. And what you can see here on the right, and we're going to ignore B, on A, we can see in nanomoles per liter, the response that patients had to major surgery. And you can see that the median cortisol in the major group, I'm going to try and move this down here. In fact, let's minimize it. The response in the major group, the median response was about 680 nanomoles per liter with a range of 375 to 1452. Now let's compare this to Plumpton and Besser. You'll see that Plumpton and Besser pretty much got up to about 1,100 nanomoles per liter. So why am I showing this to you? There are two reasons. One is that this reduction we're seeing in cortisol values is very likely to be because we have better assays that are more specific to cortisol now than in the past. So assays used in Plumpton and Bess's time, which was, I think, an in-house RIA, a radioimmunoassay, they were not very specific and they would pick up cortisol-like species. So perhaps things like 11-DOC, 11-deoxycortisol. This is no longer an issue. So we can expect that values would go down. It would be remiss of me not to mention that the other reason we might be seeing this observation is that surgery in the 1960s was probably a little bit more brutal than surgery is now. However, this major group consisted of the majority of open surgeries and chest surgeries. So you would still imagine that there is an adequate stress there. So moving on to what we did here, we retrospectively looked at all of the ITTs that we could get our hands on performed at Imperial College Healthcare NHS Trust. I'm taking credit for this, but actually this work was done by Debbie and Annabelle Hayes, who was the medical student who engaged in the BSc project with us. Now, the data that Annabelle collected starts from August the 3rd, 2020, and it concludes in January 2022. What she did was find the data, enter it into a spreadsheet in Excel, filter it in Excel, and then analyze it in Prism GraphPad. The ITTs were identified from the shared PIU drive and the letters stored on the endocrine shared drives. The reason why August the 3rd, 2010 was used is that prior to this, a different assay was used at Imperial College Healthcare. I should add, sorry, that currently we use Abbott Alinities. Prior to that, we were using Abbott Architects. And both of these assays, we've compared them and verified one against the other. So for all intents and purposes, they are the same assay. Now, the cortisol and the glucose data was collected from Cerner if it was after 2014 and ICE if it was pre-2014. The medical records were initially interrogated by Annabelle, the medical student. She classified the clear-cut cases, but if there were any ambiguous cases, they were reviewed in detail by Professor Mirren, me, Kate Lazarus, and Debbie. So this is the strobe diagram. Now, Annabelle identified 615 ITTs. The initial exclusions were quite straightforward. She removed results that preceded 3rd of August 2010, when the assay was different, and she removed duplicate results. She then did an initial review of the ITT profiles, ITT results. She found that there were 23 where there was an inadequate hypoglycemia and a cortisol of less than 500 nanomoles per liter. Now, to explain that, if there was a situation where there was an inadequate hypoglycemia, yet the cortisol was greater than 500 nanomoles per liter, the current imperial cutoff, then they were included. And that's because they've demonstrated that there's an adequate stress to raise their cortisol. There were six cases where it was an ITT we were looking at from a different center, therefore using a different assay. There were 13 cases when there was insufficient documentation. And there were four cases of active Cushing's. The reason why we've got some active Cushing's here is presumably because there were 6-week post-operative ITTs in individuals that presumably had their surgery for Cushing's disease and therefore hadn't actually gone into remission. Of the ITTs that were left, there were actually 297. And of these 297, there were 105 with a cortisol greater than 500 nanomoles per liter, so 105 passes. And there were 192 cases of a cortisol less than 500, so fails. Of the 105 that had a cortisol of greater than 500, there were 105 true negatives. We had no false negatives. So that means that everyone who passed the ITT, none of them had AI on clinical review. And we had 192 fails for the ITT. That means we had 55 true positives, of whom we had one primary, 52 secondaries, and two tertiaries. There were 137 false positives. So that's individuals who failed the ITT but did not have AI. So the results.
Hang on, let's go back to that last slide. So Amir wants to know, how do we know they did not have AI?
So they were longitudinally followed up. All of their cases were reviewed. So their CERN notes, electronic notes were reviewed. In case there were 13 cases where we did. Sorry.
Yeah, so they were not on steroids, basically, and were not ill.
Yeah, that's right. So they were not on steroids, not ill. And in clinic letters, there was no appetite almost to give these guys steroids because they didn't need it.
Some of the true positives can be false positives too, because they may be taking steroids unnecessarily.
That is very true. Yeah.
Sorry, I didn't quite catch that. Sorry.
What to say that some of the true positives were not also false positives, because they may have been taking steroids unnecessarily.
Yeah, that's a very fair point. But I would argue that it's going to be nigh on impossible to identify that group. The only way you'd identify them is prospectively by trying to take them off their steroids, right?
Which we might think about doing now.
Yeah. May I move forwards?
Yeah.
Okay. So there were 297 ITTs, and they came from 255 individuals. Looking at the data, some individuals had ITTs on up to three occasions. The mean age of the cohort was 42 plus or minus approximately 12 years. The median follow-up period was 6.67 years, which should be 6.7 years. The interquartile range is 4.9. So interestingly, at the time of ITT, 45 patients were on prednisolone, 65 patients were on hydrocortisone. After the ITTs were completed, this number became 22 who remained on prednisolone and 33 that remained on hydrocortisone. So why I highlight this is that you'll see that approximately 50% come off their steroids after an ITT. So this is the current status quo. If we are using the 500 nanomoles per liter cutoff at the moment, we end up with a sensitivity of 100%, a specificity of 43.4, a negative predictive value of 100%, and a PPV of a positive predictive value of 28.6%. We expect the PPV to be low because this is still a rare disease. But you'll see that actually we don't miss any patients. Everyone with AI, they get diagnosed. Why are we trying to change anything here? Well, the issue is the specificity. The specificity is too low. And by bringing this cutoff down, we can improve the specificity and we can prevent misdiagnoses of AI. So it's this false positive number that we're trying to bring down. I've included here what the mean cortisols for each of these groups was. So you can see that the individuals who fail the test and have AI, they have the lowest cortisols. So 287 with a standard deviation of 109. You can see those who are false positives, obviously they're going to be less than 500 because they fail the test, but they don't have AI, and you'll notice that they're actually closer to the boundary, they're closer to 500. And then the true negatives, as you would expect, 570, they're above the 500 threshold. So in order to change the cutoffs, the way to do it is a rock analysis. Now, to orientate you with the rock curve, on the left, we have, on the y-axis, we have sensitivity. On the x-axis, we have 1 minus specificity. And each of these dots, each of these points is a different cortisol cutoff, probably ascending here. And from this analysis, if we take the standard accepted sensitivity of any test, which is greater than 95%, the lowest we could bring this cortisol cutoff down to is 409 nanomoles per liter. But the issue is that if we aim for a sensitivity of greater than 95%, there will still be individuals who fail the test but actually have AI. So we might still have false negatives. And I think that's the key thing we don't want. We don't want anyone to have a missed diagnosis. So we're aiming actually for a sensitivity of 100. And this can be achieved with a cutoff of 416 nanomoles per liter, and you'll see that the specificity has come up. This is how the profile of sensitivity and specificity changes with each ascending cortisol on the right. And you can see that this is the line at which we're drawing the new cutoff, where we first hit 100% sensitivity. So this is a copy of the previous grid, but now using the new cutoff of 416 nanomoles per liter. What you can see here is that the false positives have now shifted into the true negative group. Sensitivity, as you can see, is 100%, specificity 87.2, negative predicted value still remains 100%, and the PPV has also increased. But again, it's never going to be near 100%. So that's the bulk of the results, the main results even. I've only included the remaining slides for interest. So Annabelle very kindly also compared the glucagon stress test against the ITT. There were only 55 patients who had both an ITT and a GST. And you can see here that there is no correlation between the peak cortisol of both results. We know and expect this because when you look at the endocrine Bible, you'll notice the GST cutoff is actually lower. I think it's 350 versus 500 currently for the ITT. And that's because the GST is just not as good a stress as the ITT. The problem with this analysis and why we won't include it in any publication is that we can't do a rock analysis here. We only had one patient in this entire group of 55 who were diagnosed with AI. So no rock analysis is possible, and we can't modify this GST cutoff at all. The other point of interest is the comparison of the overnight metyroprene suppression test versus the ITT. Now, unfortunately, again, we don't have much data. So there were only 28 concurrent OMSs and ITTs. And of those 28, four did not suppress their cortisol sufficiently. So that's why when you add up the tests in this grid, we get to 24. So there's not enough data here, but what we're saying is that if AI is excluded, then an individual doesn't need an ITT. However, if the results of an OMS suggest AI, then an ITT is almost obligatory. This is what this is hinting at. So we have 100% sensitivity, and a very low specificity.
Okay, I don't have any questions about that. So this one, the specificity of this is better than the ITT with a cutoff of 500, isn't it? Because that was about 40% of specificity.
I'm just, embarrassingly, I can't remember. I'm just going to go back and have a look. It was 40.
Well, the number is small though, the error is small. Okay, so what is the cutoff here for the overnight dates? What have you used?
So what you do is you give them a large dose of metyroprene, not the cortisol, and it's less than 200.
But that's the DOC. What have you used for the cortisol?
Well, you're suppressing it. So it would be, you need to make it less than 60.
200. It's 200. 200, yeah.
So both 11 DOC and cortisol 200.
No, the cortisol would be suppressed by the metyroprene 200, and then you're looking at a rise in 11
DOC. 11 DOC. What about the, sorry, I mean ACTH.
Oh,
is that, was it, we said 60.
Yeah, ACTH on a slide.
Sorry, I don't have ACTH data. Did you ask what the cut? So I think the current ACTH reference range is less than 30, although I think generally everyone agrees that's a little bit low.
Yeah, and for this we say more than 60, is that right?
I didn't think there was an ACTH cutoff for this. Am I wrong?
Well,
we
in
use,
the Bible, there is
we
an
use
60. ACTH number.
We use 60. I think it's 60.
Okay.
Thank you.
Shall I move forwards?
Yeah, please, yeah. I'll meet again.
Okay, so ultimately what I'm saying to you is that we think the ITT cutoff should be brought down to 416 nanomoles per liter. Now, if we compare to other papers, the comparisons are difficult because all of these numbers are going to be assay specific, and not everyone looks at ITTs. So remember, ITTs come with inherent risk, and therefore groups will not prospectively do ITTs anymore. It's probably quite difficult to even get ethics for it. So the first paper to consider here is Al-Fahan et al. 2013. So these guys did 165 SSTs in healthy volunteers, and they came up with these cutoffs. Alpha Han et al. Did exactly the same thing. They looked at the mean cortisol response. I think it was at 30 minutes for this, and then minus two SDs. So if they were using a GCMS assay, which is meant to be very specific, they ended up with a cutoff at SST, not ITT, of 420 nanomoles per liter. When they analyzed the same samples on the Abbott Architect, which is analogous to what we use at Imperial, they got 430 nanomoles per liter. I'll comment here that the Roche values are high, but it's likely that they were using the Alexis 1. And nowadays, most centers use the Alexis 2, so the newer version of this same Roche assay, which is more specific. Cho et al, 2014, they used a diasorin assay. They again did 208 ITTs in this case, healthy volunteers, and they ended up with a cutoff of 414 nanomoles per liter. And Jarosky et al. Prospectively picked up 110 patients with suspected AI, and all of them had SSTs. They used the Roche Alexis 2, so the newer version of the Roche assay, and they ended up with a cutoff of 403. And when they used LCMS, which again is meant to be more specific, they ended up with 400 nanomoles per liter. I don't think, embarrassingly, I've left off our work here at Imperial. We looked at about 600 SSTs, and on the Abbott Alinity and Architect platforms, we reckon that our local cutoff at 60 minutes should be 419 nanomoles per liter. So ultimately, this data is demonstrating that we perhaps should be reducing the cortisol cutoff at ITT down to 416. Remember that the SST cutoff we're now saying should be 419. And these numbers are not easy to remember. So perhaps it may be easier to tell everyone or to write that it's universally 420 nanomoles per liter for both tests. The final point, for which I don't have much data backing this, is that the OMS may have a role in excluding AI, but so far we should not be using it to diagnose AI. Certainly more data is needed. And I'm just going to finish on this slide. We're coming towards the end of the study and we are desperate for our last 7 or 8 patients. So if you do find patients, particularly who are on prednisolone, aged between 18 and 75, generally well, have been on their hormones and the levels and the doses are unchanged for 3 months and not on HRT or estrogen, please do email me their details, obviously with their permission. Thank you.
Great, thank you, Zubin. Any thoughts then about cutoffs? Because we are giving too many people steroids.
And causing harm.
I think we'll be getting below this in time.
Well, one of those studies when they go 400, because they have their definition of adrenal insufficiency will vary.
Yeah.
So you have no gold standard. You never know.
Yeah, well that's a problem. The ITT is a so-called gold standard. It's useless.
How do you compare the gold standard to something else?
Yeah, we need a better gold standard. That is the problem. We started off with a really bad gold standard, I think. You're on mute, Mubin.
Sorry, thanks. For the purposes of any of this type of analysis, the gold standard has to be what the clinical trajectory is or was. Because if you go by existing biochemistry data, you can never change cutoffs or thresholds.
The problem is, Mubin, the more anxious clinicians will say, you will only know if someone is exposed to a serious stress. So you may be following somebody up for 5 years and say they have a need for glucocorticoid, but what if they are unwell? Because it's all due to stress, and you don't know whether 415.9 is okay.
Well, the other problem is that when they do have stress and they get, I don't know, diarrhea, norovirus, and become dehydrated, they are admitted and they're told you have a crisis, but actually they haven't had a crisis. They're just dehydrated and a bit shocked and need some fluids. And they come into hospital, and we give everything, a saline, a bit of steroid, and then they recover. And it's amazing how well that hydrocortisone works. See, that is the issue.
Forgive me if I've got this wrong. It sounds like Dr. Sam. It is Dr. Sam, isn't it?
Dr. Sam, yes.
It is Dr. Sam. Hi. Professor Sam, even. Sorry. my apologies, Professor Sam. So what you've said is fair, right? That you don't know what the actual stress response will be when there's a stress, right? But you can only go off the data you have. And Plumpton and Besser, it's that that's the premise. That's the foundation upon which all of this is based. And they showed that those ITT responses do correlate to good surgical responses. And I guess the argument is that surgery in the 1960s is probably one of the worst stresses you could ever get. And everything else is based on that premise, right?
But do you think, I mean, surgery hasn't, I mean, I know it's become laparoscopic, but the ones that were in that other paper, that was major open heart surgery. So that's pretty stressful. I don't think it can be less stressful than it was.
Better anesthetic. Right, better anesthetic, better pain management. They probably didn't believe in paracetamol. Yeah, exactly. And you know, in the '60s, correct me if I'm wrong, there was no belief in analgesia during operations. Whether that has changed, because we know that heart rate can still spike if someone's under GA cut into. So these things, I think, are different. And then I guess blood loss as well. Better surgery techniques mean less blood loss in surgery. Those are the arguments I would give, but I believe that the differences we see in the values, the cortisol values, is not to do with stress, but rather is to do with assay differences. I can't back it up.
They were measuring some other things as well as cortisol. Mm-hmm. Other ketosteroids, they used to call them. Okay.
Mubin, can I ask a question? Can you hear me?
Oh, yes.
Thank you. No, that was excellent. Very, very good data. Have you actually looked at basal cortisol levels and how this compares to the ITT response?
On this occasion, we didn't. So the analysis was done by Annabelle, our BSc student. And unfortunately, that analysis was a little bit beyond the scope for her, but it is something that is worth looking at. And when we've done the same with SST data, yes, basal cortisol levels inform the size of the response in SST. And I would be very surprised if it didn't do the same in ITT. And I think some of the papers I've presented today, they've actually shown that there is a correlation between peak ITT cortisol response and the baseline. But I think you're asking this because you want to see if the baseline cortisol precludes the need to do the ITT, right?
Well, yeah, quite. So if you've got an early morning cortisol level, then you may not need it at all, if that's adequate, yes.
That would be really useful if we could do that.
So I can talk about SSTs here. So I know I'm going off the schedule here a little bit. So there's a paper by Spardella et al, 2016. And these guys actually used the same Abbott platform that we use. And they came up with a value, a morning value of 336. So if an individual has a morning cortisol of 336, then they will pass the SST, not ITT. We have found that if someone has an afternoon value of 234 or more with 100% sensitivity, they will pass the SST. So
234 in the afternoon, they're all around 150.
Yeah, they're all lower than that.
They are indeed. If you get lucky and find someone that's got 234 or more, then, but I agree that 234 is far too high. The other purpose of the other paper was that we had worked out that anyone less than 53 is worth calling out, but anyone between 50 and 100 who we have a tendency from biochemistry to call out, really kind of, they shouldn't be called out, basically. There's no need.
Yeah, more and more of them are on steroids anyway.
Yeah.
So we need to, we've got a bit of work to have. We've got to stop using ITTs. That's Florian's point. I think you're right, Florian. I think we need to, at some point, ditch the ITT completely, which is was heresy.
Are they only using 2.2 for the glucose?
Yes.
All the studies?
Yes.
Oh, some of them are 2.0, but then again, the difference between 2.0 and 2.2 is negligible because it's usually the assay or whatever. Yeah, I mean, most handheld devices are not really reliable below that number, so 2.2 is a reliable cutoff. There was one other point I was going to raise. Oh, yes. So the other thing, controversially here, that might be worth doing moving forwards is, instead of the ITT, why not do an OMS? And then those who pass the OMS, so in the initial setting, we'd need to do the OMS and the ITT. It'd be worth doing prospectively, but essentially you'd reduce the risk and reduce the burden by doing the OMS first. If individuals pass the OMS, then they don't need further dynamic function testing, but if they fail, then they are consigned to an ITT. I would add the only problem here is that you won't be looking at growth hormone, and we didn't even talk or touch on growth hormone levels. So that's the only thing that would be missing from the OMS, but still it's safer, cheaper.
But turnaround time may be a problem.
Because
that's currently more than a month, isn't it?
We send away the 11 docs.
The 11 doc, it takes more than a month to get a result.
Well, I think a cheaper plan than the OMS is a 9 a.m. cortisol. If we can get by with that, that would be.
Mubin, should it be 7 a.m., 8 a.m.? It tends to like that by 9, it's already going down, isn't it?
Yeah, so I feel like that. So if we look at, so Meyer Chow 2014 is the paper here, right? If you look at the papers, cortisol starts to rise 2 to 4 hours after an individual wakes and then peaks about half an hour after they've woken up, right? When people come in at 9, most people don't wake at 8:30. They wake earlier than that. Typically speaking, you want to catch them half an hour after they've woken up. And 9 a.m. I think is too late too.
Yeah,
because you go to the panel. And there is no point doing a salivary cortisol at home when you wake up. Has anyone looked at your salivary cortisol the moment you wake up to see whether there's a cutoff there?
I've never looked. I have never looked into that. So I am ignorant completely.
That's a good idea. But so people have looked into stimulated salivary cortisols and they seem to correlate well. For instance, if you do an SSD, the 60-minute value seems to correlate well with the serum level. And we have done that on a few patients now, but haven't got enough data to present it.